Good evening, everybody. And Merry Christmas to you and yours. Thank you so much for joining us for this Christmas Eve service here at First United Methodist Church. For those of you I've not yet had the opportunity to meet, my name's Kevin Tully. I'm so pleased that you're here. I'm pastor of the place, and I'll be preaching a little bit tonight, and I'm just so grateful that you've chosen to spend this time with us on this holy occasion. Now, I trust that everyone, as you came in, got a candle. You're going to need a candle and a printed order of worship. You'll want to sing along with the carols that we'll be joining in together. In a moment, we'll be having some prelude music presented by our bell ringers. And if you don't have a candle at that yet, you can go get one during that time. Or if you've got a dollar in your pocket, find a kid that around you and give them a dollar and tell them to go get your candle, something like that. In 2 days from now, we'll be back here in the sanctuary for our first service on the Sunday following Christmas. Let me tell you about that service. Typically, we have four services every Sunday. We have two traditional services here in the sanctuary. We have a modern-style service with a little bit of different beat and electronic music, and we have a Spanish language service as well. Well, all four congregations will be represented in the service that happens on the 26th. It's casual. There won't be any robes. There'll be a different vibe, and we'd love to have you come and join with us. Now, 9 days from now, we begin a new year, and I mention that to you because each and every year, we try and make it, we intentionally seek to offer something to those who are making a new start, as we are encouraged to do in a new year. The sermon series that will be presented here during the month of January has to do with how it is we offer ourselves more deeply to God. Everything's going to be about what does it mean to offer myself to God? And we'll be focusing on that during the month of January. If you're looking for a place to be, we'd love to have you back with us. Okay, I think that's about all I have to say except some instructions about the candles. Basically, the rule of thumb is this. When your candle is lighted, it remains uprighted. Got it? Okay. In other words, let the person next to you bend their candle toward yours. Once your candle's lit, don't be tilting it. They might not appreciate the hot wax on their legs or whatever it is. So anyway, once your candle's lit, just keep it upright. So pleased that you're here. And now that you and I are here, and God has promised to be among us, let us open ourselves to the promised presence of God Almighty on this special night. Welcome. Thank you.
give thanks to God. Tonight, our celebration is rooted in the words of Scripture and in God's promise of salvation. This is why we gather, and this is why we worship. This is why we light the Advent candles, and this is why we sing. Tonight, we rejoice in God's gift of a Savior given to you and me and the whole world. Come, sisters and brothers, let us praise God together.
Of the Advent candle.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you.
light the candles of hope, love, joy, and peace this Christmas Eve to remind us of God's gifts to us, given through Jesus the Christ, the light of the world. Jesus is the Son of Mary and the Son of God, one with us, our Lord, our Savior, our brother, and our friend. The Son of Mary brings us the hope of God. He calls us to share this hope with others. The Son of God brings us the love of God. He calls us to share this love with others. Christ, our Savior, brings us the joy of God. He calls us to share this joy with others. Jesus, our Lord, brings us the peace of God. He calls us to share this peace with others. We light the candles of hope, love, joy, and of peace as we give thanks for the gifts given us by the one who is the light of the world.
Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gather today.
Please be seated.
Everything inside me cries for order. Everything inside me wants to hide. Is the shadow of an angel or a warrior? If God is pleased with me, then why am I so terrified? Someone tell me I am only dreaming. Somehow let me see through heaven's eyes. But before my head agrees, my heart is on its knees. Holy is he, blessed am I. Be born in me, be born in me. Trembling heart, somehow I believe that you chose me. I'll hold you. You will hold me in the end. Every moment in the middle, make my heart your Bethlehem. Be born in me. All this time we've waited for your promise. All this time you've waited for
we've come to the moment when we are about to receive offering. Am I on? Okay. We've come to the moment where we're about to receive this evening's offering, and I have some specific instructions for you and some very happy news to announce to you. First, concerning the specific instructions. If you are a member of this church that is planning through tonight's offering to help finish your pledge to the church, or if you want to make sure that what you give goes to our regular church budget, you're going to have to exert a little bit extra effort. You'll need to put church budget in the memo line of your check, or you'll need to put it in one of the offering envelopes, which are in the back of the pew in front of you, and put church budget. The reason this is so is because, thanks to the generosity of our congregation, we are able to give every bit of tonight's offering, not otherwise or specifically designated, to Hope Clinic. Hope Clinic is a local nonprofit that really fulfills the work and mandate of Christ to take care of those in need, to look out for those who are underserved in our community. If you've read that part of the scriptures where Jesus says a few words about, inasmuch as you have done it to one of the least of these who are my brothers and sisters, you've done it unto me, then you'll be excited about the opportunity that is before us. All the dollars given tonight will go to Hope Clinic to help them continue their loving work of care, healing, and mercy. So, if you've got an extra 5 or 10 or 20 or 100, I would encourage you to drop it in and feel good about it. And now let's prepare to give and to share with others as our ushers come forward. Let's pray together. What a happy occasion, O God, when we remember again your love for us, when we reflect upon what it means to be included in your continuing mission, and to somehow believe that through us, the work of Jesus continues in this world. So we come to this moment excited and grateful for the opportunity that is before us. Help us be joyous and generous and happy about this opportunity to be His. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah. From you shall come forth for me one who is to rule Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until this time, when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure. For now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and lineage of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
Lord,
In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then the angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find the child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them.
I was able to write a short note to some folks in our congregation to let them know that I was happy to see them back in church. I'm not sure if it was COVID that originally took them out or if they were upset in some way. I later had a conversation with them and I found out the story. But I just wrote them a note to let them know, "I'm so happy you're back," because for several months, they weren't here. Now, it was easy for me to write that note because I sincerely felt what I put down on paper. I was happy that they are here for their sake and for ours, because I firmly believe that being in church is better than not being in church, that worshiping God along with like-minded people is better than not doing that. So, I'm happy that they are here. But here's the part that I know, and I made short reference to. I let them know that I respected so much how it is they came to come back. They made a decision. They recognized, talked to one another, sort of acknowledged, we haven't been doing very well. I miss it. Yeah, it makes Sunday mornings easier, but I don't think that we're really doing better for not being there. So they didn't just drift back, they decided to come back. Now, my reading of Scripture leads me to say that I think God's happy about their decision too. Because that's basically the rhythm and story of humanity if you read the Bible. God inviting people to come close, to learn some things, to live in relationship with God. And those people often, occasionally, cyclically, drifting away. Hey, you want a short recap of human history as recorded in Scriptures? I can give it to you. It's especially made clear in the pages of the Hebrew Scriptures, or the Old Testament, as it is sometimes called. Here it is. God chose these people, decided to reveal God's self to these people, sent prophets, communicated with them, asked to live in relationship with them, gave them some commandments so they'd know how life works best. God, pardon me, God rescued them from slavery in Egypt and called them to live in community with one another. And time and time and time and time again, over time, the people drifted away. They fell back into their old ways of doing things. They forgot God's commandments. They thought, we don't need God to help us. We can do it on our own. They got distracted with economics and politics. At several junctures in history, they decided to put their confidence more in earthly leaders and political heads of state than they trusted in God. Sometimes they even openly turned to other gods and other idols, but then they learned. Now, lest we Christians develop some kind of arrogant, condescending attitude toward our Jewish brothers and sisters, let me make sure you understand that the only reason that story isn't repeated over and over again in the pages of the New Testament is because they stopped writing the New Testament. The Old Testament, or Hebrew Scriptures, deals with about 1,500 years of verifiable human history. So there are empires that rise and fall, there are sociological trends, there are plagues that come and go. And so they've noted the rise and fall, faith-wise, of these people. The New Testament or Christian Scriptures cover only about 100 years after Jesus' resurrection. So the fact of the matter is that that story isn't retold in the Christian Scriptures, but if they had have kept writing, it would have been, because if you look at secular history, that's exactly what's happened. Why has it happened? Why has it continued to happen? Here's the answer. That's the way people are. That's the way we are. And it's the way that we can all become if we're not careful. Now, when I talk about being driven back to God or figuring out through misfortune that life without God as a part of it doesn't work, I don't mean to imply about these folks that I referred to in opening the sermon, these folks who have come back to church, I don't mean to imply that they suffered some calamity. I don't mean to say that they suffered some terrible situation in their marriage or their economics. In fact, truth of the matter is just the opposite. It was probably their affluence and their interest in many other things and their ability to go other places that kind of kept them away, sort of caused them to drift away. And yet, God welcomes people back time and time again. That's another way. God is not like me, not like most of us. If I was God, I would have said, no, I gave you a chance. I tried over and over again. I can't deal with this sort of rejection. You said no, fine, but not God. Every time God welcomes people back, was willing to start over with them. Here's what's even more amazing. Sometimes when people are walking away from God, when kingdoms were walking away from God, when tribes, when God's chosen people seem to be facing the other direction and walking away, it's as if God walks after them, calling, tapping them on the shoulder, seeking after them. Tonight, we are here because God is like that. That's what Christmas is about. God seeking after us. Anybody here of Jewish heritage? Chances are not. That means all of us are what you'd call Gentiles. There's Jews and there's Gentiles. That's everybody else. And God, through Jesus, began to seek after us, revealed God's self to us. God broadened God's reach, inviting us into relationship with himself. That's why I would say Christmas is a time for coming home. One of the joys of this evening for me each and every year, and it's already happened here this evening in this setting about five times. And it happened at 5 o'clock here in this setting about 10 times. My meeting extended members of families. It's wonderful. Some of these kids grew up here. I'm the odd man out in this little reunion or discovery of their family because the kids were a part of our community or grew up in our local schools or maybe even grew up in our church, but they moved away. And I'm able to say to the parents, oh, this is your son. Oh, this is your daughter. Oh, this is your mom. How wonderful. I'm so happy to meet you. It's a time to sort of see who's related to whom. This year, my wife Georgia and I will not get to see all of our kids together for Christmas. But on these occasional years, now that they have spouses and fiancés and this sort of thing, I know that those other in-laws want to be with them as well. But occasionally, every so many years, they're all together and they're all here and they're all with me, and I can't tell you how good that feels. All my kids together under one roof. They're safe and sound under my protection. And I think that's how God feels about what's going on in maybe this place and a lot of other places this evening. All these people coming home. All of these folks, some of whom have sort of drifted away, maybe been 364 days since they were in church, are now back. And I know that for some, it may feel awkward, embarrassing. Is he talking to me? Is he picking on me? Does he know I haven't been in church? Don't feel that way. God doesn't feel that way. Here's how I know. In one of the most famous stories that Jesus ever told, he told about a family. And we know that it's about more than just a family. It was a made-up story as far as we know. But it's meant to tell us about God. So there was a dad, and he's got a family, especially two sons, and one of them decided he was sick of dad's rules. And he demanded his inheritance early. And he said to his dad, I wish you were as good as dad. I'm out of here. And he hit the road. And he left home, and we're even given the detail that he used most of that inheritance money on partying and prostitutes. And eventually the money ran out, and he didn't have any place to go, and he realized, I have messed up. He didn't even have food to eat. And it occurred to him, you know, back on the old home place, the hired hands, those folks who are really low on the proverbial totem pole of employment around the place, they at least had three meals a day. I haven't even got that. Maybe if I go home and just ask Dad to let me work, just be among the hired hands, I'll at least have a place to sleep. So he did. Turned around and headed back home. And Jesus' words at this juncture in the story are very important and very beautiful. So Junior is dragging his sorry self home, maybe coming over the hill, maybe just drawing into view. And Jesus said, when he was a long way off, his father saw him and rushed out to greet him and hugged him and kissed him. And the father said, let's have a party. My child is home. Nothing about, hey, we're going to have to talk about what you've done. Nothing about, hey, you have some apologizing to do. Nothing about, we need to discuss the matter of restitution. And Jesus, having told that story, makes me know for certain and bold to say, no matter who you are, no matter where you've been, no matter what you have done, I'm telling you, God feels the same about you coming home. Years ago, after I'd first been appointed pastor of the First United Methodist Church of Wynnewood, Oklahoma, then a community of about 2,500 individuals, I did what you're supposed to do if you're a good and responsible pastor. Get around to see your people. Learn their names, find out who they are. Now, I had figured out that I was going to meet some of my folks by being in church on Sundays. Those who were active, those who were involved, those who were healthy and able to do so, they'd come to church and I'd have an opportunity to meet them. But there was a special list of folks, our homebound folks. They weren't likely to come to church. They had been the saints of the church for decades and generations before. It's not only right and good, but proper to go and visit these folks and let them know who I was. So I began to go around to the homebound members, and I called upon one gentleman who was listed as homebound, and I looked on the sheet and it said that he was over 90 years old. He met me at the door, he invited me in. I found out his eyesight was almost gone. His hearing wasn't what it used to be. We talked a while, sat down, asked questions of one another. I had to talk rather loudly because his hearing had begun to fade. We'd visited for about 15 minutes, and then he said to me, now what church are you from? And I said, I'm from the First United Methodist Church here in town, and I came because according to our church records, I'm your new pastor because you're a member of that church. And tears began to form in his eyes. I told him, yes. As long as you want to be, you're still a member. He began to cry. And he said, oh, that's wonderful. That's the church I want to belong to, but I haven't been able to come in so long I was afraid I wasn't a member there anymore. I was so grateful. I was so grateful that in that moment I could reflect to him how I believe God is. You might have been away for a long time, but you're still a part of the family. I know that because that baby who came, grew up into a man who brought God's message to us. He said it was so. Thanks be to God. I invite your attention to our printed order of worship as we share in the sacrament of Holy Communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. In the fullness of time, you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. And at his birth, the angels sang glory to you in the highest and peace to your people on earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. As Mary and Joseph went from Galilee to Bethlehem, and there found no room, so Jesus went from Galilee to Jerusalem, and was despised and rejected. As in the poverty of a stable, Jesus was born. So, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. As your word became flesh, born of woman, on that night long ago, so on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. In the United Methodist tradition, we celebrate what is known as open communion. It simply means this: all are welcome. It is God who is the judge of our hearts, and if anyone is seeking mercy, they are welcome. You don't have to be a part of this church or baptized in the Methodist denomination. We believe it is Christ himself who mercifully has set this table. As you come down the center aisle, you're welcome to spend time at the communion rail. There is a receptacle at the end of each of the communion rails where you can put your communion cup. We hope you will come. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. May the one who is the light of the world light your life and your pathway from this day forward. Go in peace and go in love. Amen.